to understand. Worship, let me hear it this morning. I contemplated whether I wanted to bring this up, but I do because I think there's a good point to it. If you look up in the middle of this room, there's two microphones hanging down right here. Straight up, right there. Okay? Kind of hidden. They're picking y'all up for your singing. And that's not to guilt you and say, hey, let's sing so you are picked up in the microphones. But we can use that because those that are listening in online and listen to it later on YouTube, they're going to hear you. And so you're encouraging them as much as you are everybody in here. So, look up and sing to those microphones. No, I'm just kidding. Don't do that. It's kind of weird.
Let's do a mic drop.
That's right. We won't do a mic drop on you. But just remember that as we're bringing our offering before God this morning, that we are encouraging everyone here, but also those online. I'd like to say, Lord, from the start, thank you for breaking through my heart. Thank you for tearing every chain apart. When I was lost, you made a way. You turned the darkest night to day. You are my joy, and Lord, I'd like to say,
will meet this Tuesday evening, March 8th at 6 p.m. in the Adult Education Wing. Any who have experienced any type of loss or other issues that is causing emotional distress are welcome to meet with us. If you have any questions, please call the church office. Our second Saturday community outreach meal and Camps and Corners will be March 12th, with setup starting at 9:30 a.m. For more information about being involved in this amazing ministry, please see Derek Hancock. March 13th will be Service Sunday. You will get to hear about all of the service opportunities we offer at Gateway and will get a chance to sign up to participate in as many as you desire. The Lord has really blessed our partnerships and we are excited about the work that we will be able to do in our community. March 16th is the GSM Spring Break Hangout at the Get Air Trampoline Park in Mobile. See Seth Medeiros for more details. Our next Without Walls ministry will be on March 18th during Spring Break from 11 to 12:30. For more details, please see Kelly Keith. Rock Kids, on March 18th from 7 to 11, we will have a Nerf battle here at the building. Bring a Nerf gun, ammo, and $5 for pizza. Sign up today and see Liz Tomlinson for more details. On March 20th, we will have a Gateway Children's Ministry training during the afternoon. Lunch will be provided, but we need you to RSVP at the Connect Centers by March 13th. This will be for all volunteers. Child care will not be provided for this event. If you have ever wanted to serve in the children's ministry, this is a perfect opportunity for you to get involved. If you're interested in placing membership or learning more about Gateway, scan the QR code located in the bulletin or fill out a form in your bulletin and place it in the contribution basket when it comes by. If you'd like more info about anything going on here at Gateway, stop by the Connect Center and talk to a team member. Have a great day, Gateway.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I want to welcome each one of y'all to a Gateway Church of Christ. We're so glad that you're here. A beautiful day outside and an even better day in here. If you're visiting with us, we're so glad that you're here with us. We hope that you were greeted. We hope that you feel welcome. And just want to tell you just a little thing about Gateway. Gateway exists to love God and to love others. We hope that we show that through our actions and not just our words. But also, we want to go deeper and have a growing relationship with Jesus. And there's a lot of different ways that we do that here through the different ministries and outreach programs, different Bible classes, and then one of my favorites, which is small groups, where we can really dive in into more intimate settings about that community, because that's what it's about. It's about the community with each other. Speaking about community, I heard a story this past week. Real quick, that there was this member in a gang, and he started going to church. He wanted to give his life to Jesus, so he got baptized, and he became a Christian. After a little bit, they noticed this guy was not coming to church, so they reached out to him and was like, "Hey, where you been?" And he was like, "Listen," and I want y'all to listen to this response. He said, "When I was jumped into this gang, they had my back. They were family, 24/7, through ups and downs, they had my back. And I just assumed when I became a Christian that the Christians would be like that. I didn't know it was just a Sunday and maybe a Wednesday thing." And I bring that up because that's the importance of community and how we are to be like unified together and to have this endless love for each other. This church does a great job of that, and I bring that up for an awareness. Let's not let that be the narrative. Let's do what Jesus said. Let's be unified and be there for each other. So at this time, I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to greet one another, and then we're going to continue in our worship together.
Thank you.
Opportunity to come and be in your presence to worship you, Father, and to lift your name on high. You are our God. You are the only God. You deserve our praise. You deserve our honor. You deserve our worship. For that, Father, we can never repay you for what you've done. We're so grateful, Lord, for our visitors we have today. So many from
on spring break and from different places. We're thankful to have them here, Father. We pray that, we could just share Christ with them in a special way today. Father, I pray that our hearts will be open to the message, that it might lift us up, that we might encourage others as well. And Father, I think all of us have a heavy heart for the last, 10, 11, 12 days or so with what's going on in Eastern Europe. And Father, we just pray. We know that you alone are the one that can end this, that you're the one that can intervene. Now, I pray specifically for the leaders that are involved, Father, that they would have a heart for you, that they would have a heart for your creation. Father, pray that level heads would prevail. Father, we pray for protection for those that are in harm's way. It's just in my mind anyway, it's just so unnecessary. But my way is not your way. And Father, you understand what's going on, and so we trust you in that. Father, we just pray you continue to bless us here at Gateway. We have so much to be thankful for, and just so grateful for all the good friends and examples and brothers and sisters that we have here. We just pray that we would continue to grow in our relationship with you. It's all about Jesus, and so thankful to know him in a special way. And I pray that for each one sitting here today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
I participated in the father-son silly Olympics last night. If you're regretting that, raise your hand just slightly. Forgot how competitive I was. So if you see me crying while I'm raising my hands, it's not necessarily maybe because of the song, but because my right shoulder is killing me from tug of war going against Brad Parker. And yeah, not just me and him. That would have been really funny. We have pain, we have sorrow, we have depression, we have struggle in this life. But we have a king who's overcome all that. And as this song says, my chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. This is a newer song to this church. We haven't really sang it here, but it's not a new song. It's been out for a while, so hopefully you know it. Chris Tomlin was the one that wrote this song, and it's a beautiful combination of the old song, Amazing Grace, and then the chorus, My Chains Are Gone. The rhythm's a little different, so listen up for that. But let's all stand as we prepare our minds to commune around the table with our Lord and with each other as we think about this.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught chains are gone, then I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve.
We are creatures of habit, I think. I know I am. I'm not a very detailed person. My wife is a very detailed person. That sometimes happens in relationships. But detail or not, things happen all the time, the same all the time. Look down the bulletin. This happens, then this happens, then this. Than this. You know, we have to have our bulletin and we look there, okay, what's next? What song is next? And that's kind of what we do. We're kind of that way. And we have to have a schedule. We have to be at a certain place at a certain time. That's good. But it can get a little difficult sometimes. I'm going to throw out another word. That word is tradition. There's a difference between a habit and a tradition. But there's a fine line between the two. And there's good traditions, and then there's not so good traditions. And it's difficult sometimes to really do what we're about to do without being traditional. You know, and I don't want to stand up here and just be non-traditional necessarily. But it's hard sometimes to really do what we really want to do right now. You know, and the way we should do it, with our heart and our mind and our soul, everything involved, it's difficult sometimes. And so, when I got the email about doing this week, I did what a lot of other folks do, you know, that are doing this kind of thing. And we think, and we say, well, okay, well, what can we do? We do the same old thing every time, you know. But you know what I did? I just got my Bible out and I looked at 1 Corinthians 11 and Acts 20. Because that's where we go, isn't it? Isn't that the traditional thing that we do? We look at those places. And so I got that out and I looked at it. And I started reading through there. And I got to one particular verse. I don't know why, you know how they jump off the page at you sometimes. Well, this one did. And it's 1 Corinthians 11:26. This means that every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are telling others about the Lord's death till he comes. I don't know, that just kind of hit me in a special kind of way. Because really that's what we're doing, you know, as we observe this memorial traditional feast, as we call it. You know, that we are telling everyone around us and telling the world that Jesus has died. Yes, he arose, but that Jesus has died. He has died for our sins. And so this morning, as we observe this supper, let's think about that. And let's think about that as we eat the bread and drink the cup, that we are telling other people, reminding other people, Jesus has died. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you. Thank you for the very thing that we hate that happened, the death of our Savior, but we know that it was in your plan. And we know he was willing to go to the cross and to die. He gave his body that we could live. And so thank you very much for that. And as we observe this bread this morning, help us to think about that and give you the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Father, thank you again for that blood that is for us, shed for the remission of our sins. We live in your grace and your mercy and your love, and without that, we're lost. And help us to realize that every day that we live. Through Jesus we pray.
Good morning again, church. At the front of your seats are the baskets for our time of contribution, our time to give back. And I'm actually going to read this verse a little bit later in the sermon, but it's in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 7. Paul is talking about generosity, and he says, "But just as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving." And it's that phrase, grace of giving. He didn't just say excel in giving, because any of us can give a dollar amount. Generosity is not about your dollar amount. Generosity is about the direction of your heart. So in saying that we are going to excel in the grace of giving means that if grace is unmerited favor that Jesus has poured out on us, it means everything you own, everything that makes you who you are in the world is because of Jesus. And so therefore, because it is given to you freely by him, and you own it because of him, the grace of giving says that we give with a generosity that might seem radical or crazy. I'm going to give a dollar, and I don't even know where this dollar is going to go, but I trust that the Lord's going to do good with it. This is the grace of giving. So just remember that. We are to excel in this grace of giving. We want you to excel in giving too, but we want your hearts focused on that generosity. Let's pray. God, we love you and we thank you so much for the gifts that you've given us. Most of all, Father, grace. Because without that, Father, we could not come to you. We could not approach the throne. We could not enter into the waters of baptism. We could not die to ourselves, Father. But you have said because you love us, you're going to give us your son. And Father, that means everything about who we are, all of the finances, all of the logistics, all of the vocation, all of those things stems from you. And so to excel in the grace of giving is to recognize the grace bestowed on us every day that you give us breath. And we say, we're going to give generously because of this. We love you so much. It's in your son's name we pray. Amen.
For the next 4 weeks, Seth's going to be walking us through the Next Step series, and many of you have been a part of that class over in the gym. Excited to hear about it and learn about not only what it means to be a member here at Gateway, but also just what it means to be a member of the body of Christ and what that looks like. Why do we do what we do? You know, why do we do everything that we do? Many different reasons, but this song speaks to that, and that's why we praise him. So I invite you to stand as we sing this song, and we'll hear from Seth.
He came to live a perfect life. He came to be the living word, our life. He came to die, so we'd be reconciled.
So excited to be talking with you guys. I get the next 4 weeks. One of the most common things that I was asked is, oh, so since you don't have to say it all in 1 week, does that mean you're going to preach shorter? No. You're going to get a good 40 minutes out of me, guys. I've been here 7 years. I mean, at this point, look, At this point, you're either there or you can go. It's all right. It's all right. Look, and I did it. I did the math. There are 10,080 minutes in a week you can give your preacher 40, okay? And then I started thinking, no, here's what I'm going to do. Here's what I'm going to do, because I know I'm going to talk to my generation real quick. That's kind of like that mixture of millennial and Gen X, you know, sort of thing. I know for a fact we'll kill 120 minutes doing this right here. You know I'm right. So if you want to walk up and say, you went a little long, I want you to have your screen report from your phone when you say it to me, and then we'll compare together. All right, so that took 5 minutes. So have. No, I am thrilled about the next 4 weeks, and here's why. It's going to be a very specific sort of teaching. Several years ago, when I became the spiritual formations minister, which, you know, we call it that. Y'all know what I tell people in the community? Associate minister, decently paid intern. I mean, we don't really know what it means either. We just go with it. But one of the things that they asked me to do was to come up with this way, you know, this path, if you will, to becoming a member of Gateway. You know, what is it to be a member of a body of Christ? And so we entitled this Next Steps, and it took on several forms. Obviously, we had a biblical basis for it. We used material from Francis Chan's Letters to the Church, which is where Ryan got that story from, which is really cool that he's being referenced twice now up here. A fantastic Next Steps program that was put together by a minister at the College Hills Church of Christ in Lebanon, Tennessee, and then various other resources. Now, a lot of you may remember, and you might recall, that this was the basis of our Church in Transition series. Right before we were moving out of our old building and going into Booker T. Washington, we all came together for a class in the auditorium, and we called it Church in Transition. That was the basis of a lot of our Next Steps conversation. So all of that is available online, too, so you don't even have to come back next week. You can just watch it on YouTube, and it'll be there. Now, we did that whole thing, and then obviously the last 2 years have been chaotic. You know, it was chaotic for us even without all of the other stuff. We were moving from a place we had been, a permanent place that we had been, to a high school, and then 2.5 months into the high school, you know, COVID comes and it hits, and so we readjust and we started doing that. And then we started meeting again at the high school, and Hurricane Sally knocked the bridge out. And if you remember, I mean, it was this whole thing. So for 2 years, we've kind of sat on a lot of this and talked about, you know, what is it going to be when we come into this new space? And we want people to know who we are. We want people to know what we're about. We want people to know where we're going. And so we created this Next Steps class. I try to teach it once a quarter, and a lot of you have gone through it. Well, so we started talking as Jeremy was preparing for his sabbatical. And it was basically the idea of, what if I preach through this class for 4 weeks? What if I preach through all of this? So if you are visiting, this is you going through the class right now. You don't have to come at the next one we do. If you are interested in becoming a member, this is the time for you. If you have been a member for 40 years, this is going to be a great reaffirmation of why you're at Gateway. It's going to be a great conversation that's going to re-ask the questions, you know, what is it to be a member of a body of Christ? What is it to be at a local body? How has this transformed you? How have you been purposed? How have you been affirmed? How have you been supported? How do you serve within this idea of church membership? And so, after each week, we would love for you to let us know if you want to place membership. So on your bulletin, we have added a QR code. And if, for those of you that do not know what a QR code is, it's that little box right there. All right, and what it does is you take out your phone, and you can do this during the sermon. I know you do it during Jeremy's. It's fine. And you can get out your camera on your phone, and when you hit that QR code, it's going to link you to a website. You click on that. And the first is going to ask for your name and your address so we can contact you. And then it's going to ask you a couple of questions. And I'm going to talk about this in a second. So if you click on it now, we're going to break that down a little bit. That is there for you. Now, I know what some of you are thinking. I don't know how to use a QR code, and I don't want to do this with my phone. Okay? Totally okay, because we have a hard paper copy of the same thing out at the Connect Centers. So you just walk out to the Connect Centers afterwards, say, I'd like this new member form, and we can go from there. But before we talk too much about that, Here's the first thing that we have to establish when it comes to church membership. We have to talk about the foundation. We have to talk about the truth. We have to talk about Jesus Christ. All right? We have to talk about the gospel. All right, because I could talk about the 437 programs and services that we have, and I can talk about all the ways your children can be involved and your youth can be involved and all the ways you can be involved. But without Jesus, it's all for naught. So the beginning of this is going to just be the story of the gospel for you. It's going to be the story of Jesus, because that's where we have to start if we're going to talk about church membership. The foundation of everything that has ordered our life is Jesus Christ. So this story of Scripture, this story of the gospel, is a reminder of this history-spanning, universe-creating God and His love for you. And this is why we sing, and this is why we pray, and this is why we serve, and this is why we believe. This is why we are encouraged and why we're comforted. This is bigger than anything in our lives. This is bigger than our pain and our struggles and our grief and our jobs. This spans all of eternity, and we should never grow tired of hearing the story of the gospel. Amen, church? We should never grow tired of learning about Christ, as Paul says, in whom we live, and we move, and we have our being. Yes. Christ holds all things together. So when we talk about the gospel, I went through a phase where when we were talking about the gospel, I remember they would say, well, you know, in order to have the good news, you got to have the bad news first. That's not true. All right? And those of y'all in like 1998 are like, say what? No, check it out. Check this out. The gospel begins with God's love for us. That's the good news beginning. John 3:16. Sometimes just exactly what Benny was talking about. We can get so caught up in a rote of tradition, we don't realize how earth-shattering John 3:16 is. For God so loved the world, not God so hated the world, not God was so tired of the world, not God was so annoyed at the world. For God so loved the world, all of us and all of our mess and all of our junk, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And then 3:17 says, for God did not come to condemn the world, but to save the world. This is the beginning of the gospel. And I want you guys to know this. You are loved by God. You are loved by God so much, He doesn't want to keep you where you're at. You are loved by God so much, He doesn't want you to stay where you are. So when He creates in the garden, it says, let us create man in our image. And yeah, it's plural. It's plural because it is God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. It is the community of who we worship, combined and put together with love. And they created us in their image for love. We were created by love, for love, to walk with God. This is the purpose of our life. So everything about your personality, everything about how you were formed in your mother's womb was to find this way to bring glory and honor to God. But then things messed up, and then the bad news comes in. Because Satan shows up, and Satan comes into the garden. And guess what? Satan doesn't say, hey, you need to rebel against God. Satan doesn't say, hey, let's just go have a big party. Satan says, did God really say? That's what he says. Did God really say? And so Satan's way of breaking our relationship with God was putting doubt in our mind that God was enough. Satan's way of breaking and introducing sin and futility and death was us saying, maybe we can't fully believe in what God has told us about ourselves. Maybe we can't. And so we're going to go in this direction, and we are now going to be subjected to sin and to death and to futility and to brokenness. Because Satan has said, no, 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 God is not who you think He is. And so God, instead of sitting back and going, well, I tried, God said, well, I'm going to go on a rescue mission to convince you you are who I say you are. And to convince you that you can believe what I say about you. To convince you that the sin that you are now subjected to will not define you for your entire life. That the brokenness and the pain, and that the very weapon of Satan, death, will mean nothing when I'm done with it. And so the story of Scripture, as we go from Abraham, who was blessed to be a blessing, as we go all the way through all of the fathers of the faith, as we go through all of the stories, we never lose sight of the fact that it is God pursuing His people. God coming after his people. God wanting a people to reveal him to the people that don't know him. And he did this with Israel. He said, you're going to be my peculiar treasure. You're going to be my nation of priests. You're going to reveal. And he even organized an economy, and he organized the government, and he organized all this stuff in the Old Testament. That's the parts we don't read, Leviticus, Numbers, all of that. All right. He organizes all of that to reveal his character and his desire for a people. Well, the Israelites didn't handle it super great, because what happens? They're like, well, hey, God, I know you really said that you would take care of us, but did you really mean that? Same thing. We need a king, God. We need a king. We need powers. We need authorities. We need things that look like the surrounding nations. Same as the fall. Did God really say? And God says, man, I just wish you'd trust me. I'm going to give you. That's the thing about God. He's going to give you what you ask for. And he gives it to them, and then it just continues to compound and compound, and the prophets show up, and they're revealing all about how God wants a biblical justice and a biblical righteousness and a biblical love and all of this, and we just ignore and ignore and ignore, and so God goes silent. And then finally, for some reason, when everything is perfect historically, God shows up in the flesh. The incarnational Jesus shows up. And Jesus does what Israel couldn't do. Jesus lives that perfect life. He fulfills every single aspect of the law. Jesus models what life looks like, and then even goes beyond that and says, I'm going to take the brokenness. I'm going to take the futility. I'm going to take the sin that came in Genesis chapter 3. I'm going to take every bit of it that has happened, that's happening, and that's going to happen, and I'm going to put it on myself, and I'm going to die for everyone so we can now be reunited with him. And so he goes to the cross for us because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And so when we turn our face to this Jesus and we say, I want to believe that you are who you say you are, God, and Jesus, you are what you have said, and I am not identified by this, we now get to be transformed. We are now welcomed into this gospel story. And the way that we see this in Scripture is we actually see a physical sacramental moment where we die to everything that is broken about us. We die to everything that is sinful about us. We literally, not metaphorically, we literally go into a grave of water. And we are brought out of this grave of water, new creation. This is the gospel. Notice I am not sitting here saying, hey, I think you got to get baptized. No, I think that the more you hear the story, the more you're going to want to be baptized. That's just where I'm at. This is the beginning of our membership in the kingdom of God, this choice. It's this moment when we realize that we are broken, we are separated, we are slaves to sin, and we're ready to die. We're ready to die to selfishness. We're ready to die to greed. We're ready to die to futility. We're ready to die to death. We're ready to die to separation. And so when we enter into this sacramental pool of water that signifies a grave, here's the beautiful part. We are not alone in the grave because Christ already went into the grave. Christ is in the water with us, taking our sin, taking our pain, taking our loss. Christ enters into our deserved hell. That's Psalm 139. What does it say? Even if I go into the pit of Sheol, which is hell, you are with me. That's where Christ says, there's nowhere I won't go for you, including the hell that you deserve. Come on, church. We're asleep today.
Preach it.
We come out of this water, and Paul says this in 2 Corinthians 5. New creation. That's literally how he says it. New creation. We are born again. We are resurrected. We are saved through Jesus Christ. And yes, we're saved for an eternity in heaven, but we're saved now. We're saved to change and to transform. To be sanctified, always allowing the Spirit to mold us into who God created us to be. We now live in the Spirit indwelling us. So we enter into a life that isn't quite heaven, but looks like the things of heaven. Y'all want to know what the things of heaven look like? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Why do I know that? Because that is the fruit of the Spirit. Check this out. Here's a fun thing. What was the first command that God gave the animals and people in Genesis? Be fruitful and multiply. It was a procreative statement, but it also was a prophetic statement, meaning that when we are fruitful in the things of heaven, life multiplies. When you are kind, In the name of Jesus, life multiplies. You are bringing the real life. When you are gentle in the name of Jesus, when you practice self-control and no other human is looking at you, you are bringing about the things of heaven into the world. You are being fruitful and multiplying, just as we were commanded before sin separated us. This is what happens. And I got to tell y'all, I love the oddity of baptism, a dunking in the water. And the word baptism literally means, it's baptizo, it means immersed, right? But I think the weirdness of it is part of the beauty. Do something that's not normal to signify who you are. I mean, we do this, we drink a little bit of juice and a little bit of bread, and we say, this is the body of Christ sustaining us. That's weird. But that's what makes it beautiful. Because so much of life is normal and ordinary. I want extraordinary. Right? We will sit in this building, every last one of it. Not y'all wouldn't even think twice. We put the song up there, we close our eyes, and we'd be like, drink of the blood of the Lamb. That's a weird verse. If you had never walked into a church and the first song you hear is about drinking sheep's blood, you'd be like, what is happening here? It's the oddity that makes it beautiful. It's the story around it. And so whenever somebody's like, yeah, we'll talk about baptism, it's a little weird, I love to say, oh yeah, it is. But don't we want to be different? Didn't Paul say in 1 Corinthians, yeah, this is foolishness to people. It's straight foolishness to people. The world is going to think you're weird. And yet somehow that's where the kingdom of God exists. I love that idea about baptism. Following Christ is not about making life normal or palpable or understandable. It's about entering into spaces of oddity and difference and reflecting something brand new. And I love the fact that the very act of baptism is us giving away our own license and choice as we let the person holding us put us into the water. We have no control over this. This is all Jesus. We are saying, I am giving every aspect of my life to where you can drown me right now. And it doesn't matter because I'm giving this to Jesus. This is membership into the Lord's kingdom, the Lord's church, not Gateway. Hear what I'm saying? We aren't gatekeepers of the Lord's kingdom. Okay? You do not have to be baptized in Gateway to be a member of the Lord's church. Okay? There's a lot of churches that have taught that not only do you need to be baptized, but you need to believe exactly what we believe about baptism. I'm going to tell you right now, that's stripping away the authority of Jesus over baptism. If you tell someone, hey, you can come into the kingdom of God by being baptized, but if you don't believe that it does exactly what we say it does, and you don't do it exactly how we say that we do it, and you don't think exactly how we think about it, you're actually not going to be saved. Are you Jesus? My point is baptism should never be a weapon. Baptism should never be something that we wield like a sword to smack somebody in the face with. Baptism should be this beautiful sacramental ceremony that a person wants to know Jesus. Guess what? Every one of you in here that was baptized, you didn't have it perfectly figured out when you were baptized. Nor do I. Guess what? You still don't. Guess what? We're in this together. That's the beauty of what this is. This baptism represents a beginning. It's an entry point into a new life. And from this baptism, we recognize Scripture and we recognize that we can become part of this odd collective called the church. And at some point, we want to be part of a local gathering, a community of people who have come together in the name of Christ to walk this kingdom together. Guys, this is a consequence of baptism. There is no individual salvation. The church is a collective. You don't get Jesus without the bride. All right? Yeah, thank you. You don't get Jesus without the bride. Here's what I want some of y'all to do. I want you to walk up to a man who's married and say, I want to be best friends with you. I want to know everything about your life. I want to hang out with you, but I also want to have nothing to do with your wife. Come on. You don't get Jesus without the bride. That's why this is so important. That's why this is so essential. Because when we come out of the waters of baptism, the consequence of that is now being part of this odd collective we call the body of Christ. And we join together. Now, here's where this can get a little shaky. this communal ID. Because this is counter to all of our programming of rugged individualism, privacy, you know, doing my own thing, right? And this is where church membership in a local body can become odd, but I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, all right? In your bulletin is that QR code. The very first question that we ask in the QR code is, I would like to know more about being baptized, or I want to be baptized, or I want to talk to someone about being baptized. This is not to shame you. This is not to create a weapon. This is us asking to join you at the beginning of your journey. And so there might be a response. And this is where, I'm just going to be honest, where you'd be like, so I can't be a member if I'm not baptized? Our reading of Scripture at the Gateway Church and our understanding of the kingdom of God looks to us that entry into the collective body of Christ throughout Scripture, the salvific church, began with the baptism of people. As Francis Chan has stated before, if Christ says be baptized, why do we even argue about it? We are not asking the question to you to keep you out. Please hear that. We are not asking the question to push you away. We are asking so we can celebrate with you, so we can journey with you, so we can be with you as we are all communally transformed into the person of Jesus. But see, we live in a society where everything is so negative. Oh, you haven't been baptized? Whoa, man, back off. Or, oh, I can't be a member if I'm baptized? Guys, I need to be honest. Both of those questions, when wielded as weapons, are a broken mindset. They're a post-fall mindset because they're basically saying, I'm not going to fully give myself yet because I need to figure this out. Now, look, there are some that are wrestling with it, but I've had conversations with people who have said, you know what, I'm fine. And the timbre in which they take seems to be out of an avoidance of something. And so I wonder, and by the way, I put that back on us sometimes as churches, that have we taught baptism in a way that has made it weaponized sometimes? But what if it was like this? Oh, you haven't been baptized. Let me tell you about this beautiful relationship with Christ that I have. Oh, I can't be a member if I'm not baptized. I want to tell you this right now. If you're in here and you're not baptized and you're thinking this, we want you to love Jesus with everything in you. And we will love you as Christ loves you for years and years and years until you come to know Christ. Okay? We firmly believe that the more you truly come to know Jesus, the more you come to grow, and the more you are surrounded by the true community of church, we don't have to stop you from cannonballing into this baptistry. Okay? That's how we should be talking about what baptism is. So if we ask the question, are you baptized? I want you to hear it with a passionate desire for us to want you to know Christ crucified and resurrected, not as a form of judgment or separation. Okay? All right, so then you decide you want to be part of a local body of Christ. You want to connect in with a local body of Christ. And so you say, I want to be a member at Gateway. What does that mean? It's actually really simple, which is why I love our fellowship. You are committing to come under the authority of the shepherds. You are committing to join with the mission in the world that Gateway is working on. That's our ministries and our services. You are committing to participate and grow and love the people in the seats right next to you. You are committing to mourn when they mourn, and you are committing to rejoice when they rejoice. You are committing to teaching children. You are committing to teaching teens. You are committing to teaching adults. You are committing to mentoring and discipling and being mentored and discipled. You are committed to serve the poor. You are committing to serve the widow and the orphan. You are committing to be a part of a family right here in Pensacola, and you get access to our directory. And it has our calendars and all the ways you can do all these things. But I'm going to tell you right now, here's why I don't put a lot on the directory. You don't get the directory. You don't get the calendar. I'm going to tell y'all, this is not a country club. This is not a country club. Membership is a transformative community of believers who believe this way of doing life is what God has called us to and to reveal Him to the world. Keep that in mind. Always keep that in mind. So now we come to it. It's the prophetic part. Y'all know I'm not going to have a sermon without poking you a little bit. This part Langston's ready for. This is not always what membership looks like in churches today. No. In a lot of churches, membership just looks like Sunday morning attendance. In a lot of churches, membership just looks like grumbling over change in preferences based on how long you've been there and how loud your voice gets to be. In a lot of places, membership looks like losing the wonder and the glory and the passion and the hugeness of the story of God because we aren't singing the songs that I like. In a lot of places, membership is, man, we sure do love what the church was 20 years ago, but we definitely don't like where it's going now. In a lot of churches, membership just becomes an offshoot of our cultural indoctrination, which is here to consume, to be satiated, to have our ears tickled, to be told just enough to be a nice person, but not enough to have to really sacrifice too much in our daily lives. And in a lot of places, us ministers, we just roll with it. Eventually, be it for economic or social or political reasons, we ministers tend towards maintenance of stability rather than the expectation of conversion. I don't think y'all heard me. I'm going to say that again. Yeah. The maintenance of stability rather than the expectation of conversion. What is the expectation of conversion? It's encountering the living Jesus Christ every day of your life. It is getting out of bed and being blown away and turned upside down by what Jesus is going to do through you. That's what it is. It's Saul on the road to Damascus persecuting the church, and Jesus shows up in a bright light, blinds Saul, and Saul's entire life for the rest of his life was the expectation of conversion. He never forgot that moment. He never forgot that voice. He never forgot Ananias putting his hands on him. Every single moment of his life, Paul's entire theology was changed because of the expectation of conversion. Paul never thought there was a moment, well, the Spirit can't do anything else now, thank you. Paul never got to that place. It is the first century church literally changing their economic status to take care of people. They gave all of their possessions. It is opening of their home. It is a radical hospitality and a love. It is an expectation of conversion that if we open ourselves up to the Spirit might do something. But the maintenance of stability says, yeah, but we don't want them to do that much. Us ministers fall victim to that when it comes to membership. The maintenance of stability rather than the expectation of conversion. And so we become members for what? Preferences met. To be comfortable. Be simply fed. Y'all, I need to tell y'all. I'm not trying to be a minister of a country club. I'm not. I want to be a minister of an earth-shaking, all-consuming kingdom led by the God of angel armies, bought by the blood of Christ, sanctified daily in the community of Pensacola. Commitment. Expectations, desires, visions. These are the words that I want to traffic in because these are the words that the Spirit says, no, the church is meant to change the world where you're at. The church is meant to do things. These are the words of a local body of Christ, but they could make us feel uncomfortable. We're scared to ask you guys to be committed because honestly, we're scared that you might get tired of it and carry your money away with you. We are scared of asking you to adhere to a set of expectations because you are here on your own accord. You have chosen to come to this place. But what's wild, though, is we're just wanting what we know that we can do. And so commitment, expectations, desires, visions. It's the reason, I'll be honest. It's the reason that if you come up and you're like, I'm very interested in being a member at Gateway, but, you know, I really don't like the green and the blue chairs and are sparse. It's the reason that I'm not going to be able to fix my face when you say that to me. I mean, it's not because I want to be like, look, I love you. But that's not what church membership is. I don't care what kind of, if we come in here, there'd be no seats. I can still worship God. Might actually be more orthodox. Here's my point. I can tell you this from the leadership. In all of this conversation, what we want from you guys is to know Christ more and more at Gateway. That's what we want. And we are going to do this imperfectly. Don't agree so quickly. We are going to say things wrong. I'm not. Jeremy will. I'm not. Check this out. We are going to fail here and there. We're going to come up with ministries that are going to flop. We're going to come up with activities that aren't going to go well. We're going to plan things that aren't going to do well. We're going to have, it's going to happen. That's why the Spirit's so awesome, because still works in the midst of all of that. We're going to try to make much of the name of Jesus. This is our goal. And so I take us back to baptism and membership. We are resurrected anew. We are a new creation. We are newly purposed. Church, listen, your sin no longer defines you. God made him who had no sin to be sin so that we could become the righteousness of God. The death we deserved was swallowed up by Christ, and we get to live transformed lives full of the Holy Spirit, the guider and the counselor promised by Christ. Our gifts, our personalities, your jobs, your relationships, since they're part of who you are, they were also baptized. So we begin the reality of God's kingdom, knowing that our lives are completely transformed. And then we realize this is not personal, it's for a people. So membership at Gateway is something we do so that people can be a part of the body of Christ, identifying with who we are and what we are about, giving to the ministries that we work on. We come under the authority of the elders, which means that we let these men shepherd us because they love Jesus. We let them guide us. We let them admonish us. We let them rebuke us. Because guess what? We all still got some sin in us, and the church is about calling that out. This is not about a time to where we say, well, once I become a member, you know, you can only let me have my life. I'll do this and I'll do. No. You are, well, do you know what confession is? It's inviting someone into your life to be accountable with you. It's not just saying, hey, I sinned, forgive me. It's, I sinned, forgive me. And by confessing, it's an invitation for us to do this together. We let our shepherds make decisions. We let our shepherds study and pray. And we let them make declarations over who we want to be as a body of Christ. And we trust that they are focused on Jesus. They are. I'm privileged to sit with them every week. They are. It is not about consuming and receiving things exactly how we want them. It is about participating and engaging, working towards the kingdom of God together with other believers. It is not about having preferences met or even expectations of worships, gatherings, services always catered to. May we never lose sight of that. Now listen. If you are a member here who comes on Sunday and sits on Sunday, I want to tell you something. I love you. I love you with everything in me. I will minister to you. I will teach you. And I will walk through this life with you. But I want you to know you are called to more. We're all called to more. Packing pews means nothing if we aren't trying to be like Jesus in our lives and in our community. We could have 1,000 people in here and not do a single thing for the community in the name of Jesus. I love you. You are called to more. Please know that you are loved. And I say this to my, why do you keep saying this? Because it tends to be sometimes the people that do come on Sundays that feel like they might be getting left behind. We love you. Come with us. I'm not saying this to shame you. I'm saying because I believe Ephesians 3:10, where it says the church is the manifold wisdom of God. And I'm going to tell you right now, I just don't see the hugeness of the story of Jesus. And I can't have someone say, you are the wisdom of God, and then think that after an hour and a half of sitting down listening, I've done my part. We don't schedule things as a church to give you busyness. We do it to change our own hearts and to transform the community. We don't serve our time in our lives and then get to a place where we can be complacent or apathetic. We find new ways to continue to grow. That was the introduction. We're going to move quick here because that's the foundation. I've sat through a lot of Next Step stuff, and they tend to jump to the what I'm about to go to very quickly, and that's fine, and they do amazing work. I'm going to tell you, and I am going to move through this quick. I know I'm a little nervous, but it's very simple. Everything we talk about with church membership. Next Sunday, we're having Service Sunday, where we're going to share all these partnerships and give you ways to be a part of it. We're going to talk about the children's ministry. We're going to talk about the teen ministry. We're going to talk about adult education. We're going to talk about how we organize ourselves. None of it means anything if we don't understand the story of God in our own lives and why we're a part of a body of Christ. So that's why this is important to me. I'm not going to rush to, okay, Seth, yes, thank you. Jesus took care of us. Now what do I need to do? I'm not going to rush to that because the Jesus taking care of us part is what pushes us. That's what keeps us. By the way, the more you get locked into the gospel story, you ready for this? The less you have problems with how things are going in the future. True story. True story. So what do we want? I've never used this before, so... What is church membership? Church membership is functioning membership. Let me find my scripture page here. 1 Corinthians 12, 27 and 31. Now we are the body of Christ and each one of you is a part of it. Can we just let that sit there? You're a part of this. You have a function. God has put you in this place. So God has appointed, first of all, the apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then workers of miracles, also those having gifts of healing, those able to help others, those with gifts of administration, those speaking in different kind of tongues. Eagerly desire the greater gifts, and I'll show you the most excellent way. Love. Follow the way of love and eagerly desire spiritual gifts. It's very simple, church. We want you to be involved. We want you to discover your giftedness and how God has created you and organized your personality, and we want you to find a way to engage it. We want you to participate in things at Gateway, not because you have to, but because it's just who you are. Y'all listen to this. Mission and service are not functions of the church. They are the church. Did you hear that? With the way we organize stuff sometimes... Well, the way we compartmentalize stuff, we think that the service and the events and the missions are auxiliary. Those are the extracurricular things, and church is the hour we spend in hearing worship. No, it's all church. We do not serve as an activity of the church. We serve to show that we've embodied the very nature of Christ in our actions. So when we ask you to come to a service thing, We're asking for physical help, but also as a means for us to be transformed into this is who we're going to be at Gateway. Church membership is unifying membership. That's what the entire blended series was about. Jesus' prayer, my prayer is not for you alone. I pray for those who will believe in me through their message, that all may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they might be one as we are one. I in them and you in me. May they be brought to complete unity to let the world know you sent me and have loved them even as you love me. Jesus is praying in John 17, and his prayer is that we as a church be so unified the world takes notice. Which is one of the reasons why we're partnering with other churches in the community. Because one of the great divisions that we have in a community is 4,000 churches that don't have nothing to do with each other. The world is not impressed by that. The world is not drawn into the attention of that. The world goes, see, y'all are no better than we are. That's what happens. That's what unity is. It is being unified, and here's how I say it. It's being an answer to Jesus' prayer. That's what the church is. Ephesians 4, 1 and 3. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you've received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. Y'all hear that? Why is unity so important? Because disunity destroys the kingdom. Simple as that. Why is unity, being a unified membership, so important? Because when we bite and devour against each other, we are not professing the kingdom of God. We are not living as the body, the bride of Christ. We are to build one another up. We are to encourage one another. We are to owe nothing to one another except love. We are to honor one another with our words. These are all scriptures. We are to be an environment of safe vulnerability and welcome. Check this out. In too many churches, unity is purchased by the world's means. Suppression of info, deceitful flattery, niceness, pushing things under the rug, avoiding any semblance of disagreement. Somehow we have decided that disagreement means unity. Guys, there's not always both sides are right. Sometimes biblical justice is right. Sometimes biblical righteousness is right. Sometimes someone can be wrong. We are caught in a blender to where we think that there has to be the perfect space in between two things, and then we call it unity because we aren't disagreeing. No, sometimes we have to get into it to be unified about what the kingdom of God is. So one could say, I mean, it's this, the squeaky wheel gets the grease, right? Well, why? Because the squeaky wheel has a rightness, or it's because we just want them to be quiet, because we want to push that under the rug, we just want everything to be peaceful, or everything like that. No, sometimes it's saying, hey, in the name of Jesus, that's wrong. In the name of Jesus, if you can't go to a church because they've got green and blue chairs, you're not right. That's not unity. Being a unified membership. Building one another up. What if we filled the atmosphere with encouragement when we came together? Here's your homework. Next Sunday, encourage and build up at least one other person when you walk into this building, period. Just do that. Every single one of you, do that. Can I tell y'all how pervasive this is? I know I said it quick. I lied. This is why, I'm going to be honest right here. Not that I've lied before all this, but... Sometimes the fear of disagreement, of disunity is so prevalent that ministers, when they receive a text message from church members, 99% of the time when it dings and they see a church member's name, their first initial emotion is hesitancy and concern. Y'all want me to be vulnerable? Period. You ever want to stress me out? Text me on a Friday night at 7 o'clock. I don't care what you say. If I see your name and you're a member of the church, I do. I get a flare up. Now, a lot of that might be my own neurosis. A lot of that might just be church. We're always thinking about these little bitty things, right? Let's encourage one another. Let's build one another up. Church membership is not about my preferences and desires. Mark 9, 33 and 37 is when they're arguing about who is the greatest, and Jesus brings a child up and says, you're to be a servant to all. There's so many scripture. Jesus says, deny yourself and take up your cross, which means it can never be about your preferences because you've denied yourself. Paul says in Philippians 2, do nothing out of selfish ambition, but in humility consider others better than you. These verses should be said one time, and then we all got it figured out, and we go about the next thing. But we know that's not always true. Because what happens is this church can become about consuming. Church is about being fed. And I'll confess, our way of elevating me on a literal stage and you sitting there quietly listening to me has affected that. It has. The very makeup by which you are sitting in an audience staring at a stage has disrupted the idea of making it kind of an American Idol thing. It has. It's made it that way. How do we disrupt that with this idea that church is about aligning ourselves with kingdom principles? It's about joining with those that believe as we do and engaging. How do we align ourselves and think about how church should be about letting the Spirit work through our times of gathering and our events and our programs to transform our lives? I'm going to tell you, I don't visit churches now, walk out and be like, that was good, that was bad. I got to worship God. I'm telling y'all, it could be the most conservative 10 people singing, or it can be a 5,000 member band. If I walk in there and say, I get to be in the presence of God today, I'm going to hear the presence of God. It's as simple as that. Because it's about releasing who you are. It's about walking in, looking at the songs and saying, I sure am glad that God woke me up today so I can even sing to him. Right? It is not about that. I want to hit this real quick. It's a lot. You can pull out your phones and take a picture of it. This is what we talk about when we say preferences and desires. This comes from Tom Rainer, thousands of churches. Here are the patterns that divide churches. Worship wars, prolonged minutia meetings, facility focused, program driven, inordinate demands for pastoral care, attitudes of entitlement, greater concern for change in the gospel, anger and hostility, and evangelistic apathy. Here's why I bring this list up. Because when I do the Next Steps class, I make Gateway sound real good. Real good. Y'all, they're like, man, y'all have no problems. We have all of these things. And every church has all of these things. That's why we name them. We name them so the Spirit can begin changing who we are as a people. So membership at Gateway means that you are personally going to remove self and pray that God opens up your heart to what's happening in the community around you in the name of Jesus. I get to come up with some of this stuff and I don't like it. The point is we're not always going to have that thing that's going to just align perfectly. But when we let that fester and burn, this is what happens. These are the things that pop up. We are to treasure church membership like a gift. Ephesians 2, 8, 9, for it's by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not from yourself, it's a gift from God. When's the last time you sat down in this building and said, I get to be in the presence of God today? When's the last time? Here's a good way to remind you. You're sitting in a building that was a gift. It's a brand new building. Y'all, I say this to everyone. Jeremy and I were not kicking butt and taking names, and people were like, we want to give y'all tons of money. We were sitting in our offices, planning Bible class and events, and someone walked in and said, here's a bunch of money. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to, look, tons of work has been done. Hear what I'm saying. It's a gift. You are sitting in a gift. This is our church membership. You get this. We get to be here. We get to sing. We get to pray. We get to listen to sermons. We get to do all of this. This is a gift, church. Come on, y'all, don't be so quiet. Act like it's a gift. It's Christmas Day every day. We get to be in this place. We get to worship this God. We get to do this service. We get to do this because of what God did for us.
Amen.
So what do we want? I'm moving fast. Hang on. We want you to follow Jesus faithfully in your life. We want your day job changed. All right? You can all be Christian in here. We want you to be Christian on Monday too. Okay? We want you to be Christian on Facebook. We want you to be Christian at the restaurant. We want you to be Christian everywhere. We want you to follow Jesus faithfully. We want you to participate in worship service. When you become a member here, whether you're online or here, we want you to be here because we want you to be encouraged and we want you to be uplifted. We want you to be in Bible class or group, and I just lost 50% of you statistically, because we do not do Bible class in a vacuum. Everything that our teachers prepare and pray over and put together is to make you come to know Jesus more and more. All right, I'm never going to walk up to you and say, I think you're wrong for not being in Bible class. I will never, ever, ever do that. But I can tell you that you'd be a lot more if you did. Okay? Because it's opening up the word with our brothers and sisters. We want you to serve others in ministry, not because you have to, because it's just the outpouring of who we are. So when we have next Sunday, you are going to get an opportunity to put your name and phone number on an actual service. Don't do it because you have to. Do it because it's part of who God has created you to be. We want you to reach out to a friend or neighbor in the community. That's evangelism. Because guess what? I don't have to beg any of y'all to be Alabama football fans or Auburn football fans. I don't have to beg any of y'all to like music. I don't have to beg any of y'all to go up to someone and share the amazing restaurant experience that you just had. We surely shouldn't have to beg you to go and talk about Jesus, right? This is who we are. This is the outpouring of what we are. People should know you follow Christ even if you don't even say you follow Christ, because it pours out of you. That's Luke 11, 45. When the light fills you up, it begins to find all the ways to pop out of it. That's what we want. We want you to give generously. We want your money, okay? Okay, you can laugh. It's okay. All right? No, we want you. It's exactly what I said in the communion. Generosity has nothing to do with your dollar amount. I don't care how much you give. I care how you give, because I want you to believe that it's going to go towards the kingdom. Simple as that. It's a freedom. It's a grace to give generously. We want you to build others up. And so what we hope to produce, and this is the conclusion, devoted worshipers. Not invested. Investing means you're going to get something in return. You already got what you're going to get, and that's Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ says, I'm going to let you be in community. And how beautiful is that? Devoted means that you have to be a part of it because it's overwhelmed your life. If I told you you couldn't come to church next Sunday, you'd smack me in the face and say, yes, I can. That's devoted, okay? You want to be there and you want to worship. And guess what? Worshiping is not standing still. Worshiping is not hands raised. Worshiping is what's pouring out of your heart, okay? So you can be as stoic as you want to be, or you can be as expressive as you want to be. It's what's pouring out of your heart, because we're worshiping the God who created us, who gave us the breath, who gave us everything about what we are doing here. We want you to be equipped disciple makers. We want to give you the tools, Bible class, life group, opportunities to serve. We want you to grow and to learn to continue to be a Christian. And then we want you to find someone here, grab them and say, come learn how to be Jesus with me. That's what we want. We want you to mentor. We want you to text somebody up. Older men looking for maybe some of the other men, older women that, by the way, this is 1 Timothy. I'm not making this up. This is all biblical, okay? Normally when I do this class, I have a ton of scripture on the wall, so y'all know I'm not lying to you, all right? This is what we want. We want you to make disciples. We want you to be spirit-filled missionaries. When you step foot out of this door, you're a missionary. Done. Simple as that. Because you are bringing Christ into the world that does not know Christ. And we want you to be spirit-filled. You know what that means? The Spirit could show up in places you don't even know. Which means that everywhere you go, you are waiting for the Spirit to reveal the reason that you're there. All right? Every interruption in your day, instead of treating it like an interruption and being annoyed, maybe we treat it like Jesus and say, okay, Spirit, what are you trying to tell me right now? What are you trying to reveal to me? Every interaction you have, Spirit-filled missionary, we want you to be suffering sojourners. Sojourners mean we know that this is not our home. Our citizenship is in heaven. And the reason we say suffering is because of this. We don't want you to come into this place fake. We don't want you to come into this place acting like you have it all together. Because guess what? None of us do. We don't want you coming into this place leaving your pain in the car because you're embarrassed to share it. We don't want you coming into this place overwhelmed by addiction, overwhelmed by a sin that you can't kick and you think you can't tell somebody. Somebody about it. We are to suffer together as a body of Christ. We share our pain. We share what's going on in our life. We share who we are during the day, and this should be a place of healing. That's why we're suffering sojourners. We constantly remind each other the suffering you're going through is not the end of your story. Let me show you a glimpse of heaven just by loving you right now, and then we'll get there. So over the course of the next several weeks, we're going to talk about how we organize ourselves and we order our body. I want to encourage you to scan the QR code or find someone. All right, I told him I was going to do this. I want my shepherds to stand up real quick. My elders. Elders, stand up. These men love you and they want to be in life with you. If you scan the QR code, find me, find them, talk to them. Find somebody with a welcome thing at the Connect Center and ask them about what it is to be a member. If you need to talk about baptism, let's do it. We don't want you to be baptized to be a member of the Gateway. We want you to die to yourself and become a new creation in Jesus Christ and join this with us. God has invited us into his house. God has invited us into his home. God has invited us into his story, his world, his very essence. This is the expectancy of conversion, and this is church membership. This is fun. This is joyful. This is exciting. This is wonder. And I hope that you join us. I want to invite you, if you want to come forward, if you have any prayers, if you have any needs, if you want to talk a little bit more, and we can create something down the road this week. If there is anything you need right now, you can go to the tables where we'll have a few people set up, or you can come up here to me. Please feel free to do so as we stand and as we sing.
Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. I will seek you in
We have two prayer requests and an update. Chris Kerb handed me this. Chris's mom, Elaine Simmons, she fell and she actually has broken her arm and shoulder area so bad that she scheduled a shoulder replacement for this week. So please pray for the Lord's guiding hands over the doctors for healing. So that is Chris Kerb's mom, Elaine Simmons. And then Charlene Jones has handed me this update to share with you. Thank you for your prayers on my behalf regarding my recent surgery. Surgery on February 21st went very well, praise God. I don't know how my physical recovery could have gone any better. A small cancerous mass was removed from the duct, and she'll be seeing two oncologists in the near future who will decide whether further treatment is necessary. That's a great pray, Charlene. We'll continue to pray for you, and we'll pray for Chris's mom, Elaine. I'm going to invite Mike to the stage with I messed him up because I did go too long, and I'm sorry, but he's got a great presentation for you guys, and have a blessed day, and we look forward to seeing you again.
Yes, it has been a long day, but this is an exciting to be in Gateway at this point in your life. God has given us a new facility with which we can grow and better spread the good news. And if you look, you can clearly see His hand in everything that we've been through in the last 2 years, 3 years. He found us a buyer for the facility when we were not even looking for a buyer for our old facility. He found us a new location. He found us a place where we could worship in the interim while we're building. He found us the right architect, the right builder, and here we are with a facility which will be a base from which we can provide a beacon for Christ for many years. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about the budget, and out at the Connect tables, you can find these leaflets which explain the budget in great detail. Budget, just a couple words. The budgets for the last several years, or past years actually, were fairly consistent. We had a history of expenses, programs, and contributions with which we could depend. The last couple of years have been more difficult because of the temporary expenses associated with accommodation for and completion of the building project, and not to mention the impact which virtual worship has had on the consistency of our contributions. Last year, in order to cover our operating expenses, we actually had to at one point reach into our emergency contingency funds in order to cover our day-to-day current bills. Fortunately, the level of contribution came up at such a time that we didn't have to go any further into those. But we want you to be assured that from the surplus not expended on the building project, we are repaying that which was taken out of the contingency funds. And after that remittance, the building funds remaining will be held in reserve for future building needs. And they're a significant amount of funds, and we'll be explaining those further in another presentation. So for your information, as I said, we have these outside. The operating expenses have been estimated for 2022, and we expect to monitor them very carefully against the contributions, and if we have to make adjustments, we'll make adjustments. Ministry leaders have already received their budget portions and respect for their respective areas, but we want you to all understand that that we understand things change from time to time, and if we have to, if we have some unanticipated expenses in one budget area or not, we will review those to see if perhaps we might be able to remove funds from another part of that same budget to apply to the need. The elders very much appreciate your faith and support over the last few years as the facility was put together. And we ask that you continue to pray with us for God's continued guidance as we seek to use it in ways which will glorify Him and advance His kingdom. Pray with me now. Father God, we are so grateful beyond words for your gift, your tool, your instrument by which we can advance your kingdom here in Pensacola and abroad. Show us your will as we seek ways to use it as a base from which we can be stewards of what you so generously provided. And the church said, Amen.
Amen.